Okay. Hi everybody. Welcome again to this webinar about MLOps on cloud. I'm Tommaso, one of the speakers for today. Let's review our agenda for this presentation. Sorry, just a second. Okay. So, after a brief introduction about us and about our company, we will talk about machine learning in the real environment, cloud infrastructure, and finally, we will show you a simplified demo of a real project developed by one of the other speakers. As I said, my name is Tommaso. I'm a data scientist in Target Reply, and I work mostly in risk and finance department in different industries, such telco industry and automotive industry. Please, Andrea, if you want to introduce yourself.
Sure. Thank you, Tommaso. Hello, everyone. I'm Andrea Magrinelli. I have a master's degree in computer science, and today I will try you to show a little introduction regarding the cloud and how we are using the cloud in order to deploy machine learning project and in general project on the cloud. So up to you, Danilo.
Thank you, Andrea. My name is Danilo Parisi. I'm a mathematical engineer and I was graduated at Politecnico di Milano. Now I'm working as a data scientist in Target Reply for insurance and finance company. At the end of the session, I will show you a demo session. So I'll let you to Tommaso.
Okay, thanks Danilo. So, as you probably understand listening our experiences, Target Reply is a data company and we work with all kind of data in order to get insight that at the end are able to support the decision process of our customer. In this slide, I want to show you a general pipeline of our work. We start with raw data and we follow all the steps, such as data integration and of course data analytics and machine learning until the final one, when the data is ready to be used by our customer and generate the value. So we can move on to the webinar. And the main objective of this webinar is underline the problems that a data scientist has to face in real environment. We mostly focus our discussion on the problems that come from the deploy phase, in particular the issue caused by moving a machine learning project from local or some dev environment, quindi develop environment, to the production environment. In this slide, I want to show you how this problem affects very different areas from academic to enterprise company. And the first quote is a quote from Andrung, that is a pretty famous Stanford AI professor that is also founder of Coursera and deeplearning.ai. I think many of you know him. And during a conference, he said that AI has created a ton of value, but a challenge, almost a bottleneck, to create even more values is bridging the proof of concept or POC to the production gap. So in his presentation, he talks about his difficulties to move academic ideas or cutting edge projects to the production, to enterprise company. In particular, he focused the discussion on explainability problems and architectural problems, and we'll talk about them in the following slide. We continue with another quote from a paper by Algorithmia. Algorithmia is a company that operates in AI fields with their own product. Every year, Algorithmia produces a very detailed report about the state of art of machine learning in companies. I think that in this quote, there are two key points. The first one is that the AI budget are on rise. So it's a good idea probably to start a career or to start to work in this area. And the second point is that the 55% of companies have not deployed a machine learning project. Of course, here we are talking about companies that want to deploy a machine learning project. This percentage is pretty high and clearly reveal some kind of problem. In this report, the attention is on privacy issue, for example, our GDPR. Indeed, not all the data that a company collect could be used for modeling purposes. And also focuses on the long time needed to adjust a POC, so a little project to the production environment to become a real project. Finally, we have a last quote is from a similar report produced by Osservatorio Digital Innovation della School of Management del Politecnico di Milano. And also in this case, the report talks about, in general, about the distance between data science idea and the business needs, but focusing on the Italian market. To sum up, the problem of moving a machine learning project from dev to production is affecting all the AI chain from university to enterprise business, and also here in Italy. A challenge that we often face in our work is to fill this gap for our customer. Okay, in order to understand how we can do that, so how we can address the problem for our customer, I think that we have to keep in mind which are the key steps of a machine learning pipeline. So in this slide, I sum up five steps that I think are always present when we develop a machine learning project. The first one is define project and objective. And of course, we have to start the starting point of a project must be a customer need. We have to define precise objective and we have to explain in advance the value of our work. Acquire and explore data is a key step because in this phase we have to we are forced to face the actual architecture of our customer. Indeed, the result of our work will be probably integrated in that system. The third one is analyze and model data. Here we just build our model. And I think that this step is more close to your experience. And we will talk about it later. The fourth is interpret and communicate. This is a pretty difficult task in machine learning because the results must be an explanation, a business explanation. If you are classifying, for example, transaction, searching for bank fraud, or you are classifying X-ray images searching for some disease. We have to explain the reason, or at least give an idea behind the prediction itself to an agent in the first case, to a doctor in the second case. I think that this point is quite challenging from technical and functional point of view. Sometimes it's difficult to understand why a model takes a particular decision. Sometimes it's more clear, but it's difficult to translate in a business language. The last point is deploy and maintain. So we have to integrate our work in the customer ecosystem, and probably we must speeding up the computation and exploit all the available resources. From now on, the discussion will be mostly focused on this activity. So before leave you to Andrea, I have just a couple of slides. The first one that I actually stole from a colleague show the hard life of a data scientist. Indeed, the life cycle that I present to you is just a dreamy situation because in the daily work things are much more complicated and interconnected. So typically in ordinary project we start with a brilliant idea that come from us or come from the discussion of with our customer, and the first step of course is run to realize it at the best of our knowledge, so facing all the modeling issue. So we choose the right model, we tune the model, we evaluate, and so on. At the end, we must show the result of our work to the customer, and if it's okay, we have to deploy the model. So we start to talk about it, for example, with some data engineers, and often we discover different problems related to the fact that the environment is most complex than we expected. And we must do a lot of rework. And in general, here we stuck. Because this scenario is a pretty common picture of data science project, people are starting to talk about possible solution. In particular, are start to talk about machine learning operation. What is machine learning operation? MLOps is a solution of this problem, of course, the medicine of this painful life. And is a sort of design pattern and offers a methodology to develop a machine learning project. And inspired by this methodology, several cloud services and many software platforms are born in order to follow the entire life cycle of machine learning, supporting the collaboration and the integration between teams. In this slide, I will show you four key points of this methodology. The first one is that machine learning should be collaborative. So MLOps encourage teams to make everything that goes into production visible, from data extraction to model deployment and monitoring. Why? Because this letter have always available a kind of big picture of the project. Machine learning should be reproducible So in software development, versioning code is the standard, but machine learning in general requires more. We have to version also the train data, the data in general, as well as the parameters. In case of failure in production, this led to reproduce the exactly behavior of the model in a sandbox, in a dev environment, in order to debug, to debug the issue better. Machine learning should be continuous. Here we are talking about retrain the model, and the retraining, in general, retraining a deployed model should be an effortless operation. And finally, machine learning should be tested and monitored. In general, the monitoring of performance is such that latency or predictive performances should be also continuous, because it can reveal the necessity of retrain, so the previous point, or the necessity to make some kind of change due to external causes. Okay, as I promised, now I leave you to Andrea that will show you how the cloud environment could simplify the deploy phase and the collaboration between teams. Thank you.
Thank you, Tommaso. In the meanwhile, let me see if I have the control. Yes.
Okay. Sorry, Andrea. Yes. There is a question for Tommaso, I think, in the chat.
Yes, I saw it. Yes. I don't know if you want to have a look at it now or after in the Q&A space. It's up to you.
I don't know. We can answer.
Because I think Tommaso.
At the end.
We can answer all the questions at the end during the Q&A session.
Yes, okay. I think it's useful.
Okay, perfect.
Okay, so as Tommaso said, in order to show you a real use case of a machine learning project, I will make you a short introduction regarding all the main types of cloud computing that are available on the market right now. Maybe you had already a look on it, but you know, it's the starting point. So, okay. What are the main types of cloud computing? I hope that you have already seen this picture. So this table is pretty common in the cloud environment. The object in blue are the one on your behalf. So the one that you have to manage when you have in this kind of situation. While the orange one are the services that you pay for and let others control. So for example, on-premises are server infrastructure or simply your machine where you can deploy your code and have a look on it. Then the introduction of the cloud as an initial logic that means, hey, give me a virtual machine. I don't want to think about hardware. I don't want to think about networking or storage. I just want to install all the things that I need and start develop my code. After years, cloud providers start to think about a single platform, the name platform as a service, in order to simplify the offers. So create the platform, power it on, like a database, like a general service, and don't think anything else about your application. After that, they deployed a sort of software as a service that is like Dropbox, Google Suite, or the Salesforce application that offers you directly all the services. They enables you to get what you need and don't have to think about anything else. So this one is a clear picture of what cloud provider offers. In general, they are starting offering from the infrastructure as a service, but a lot of new services are based on as a software with this pattern, so software as a service. So the end users are related to this last level, while application developers are in the platform as a service level. So going next, right now in the last few years, a new model has been found, so the function as a service. What does it mean? In this scenario, you are using all the functionality given from a specific programming language, and you can run easily your code serverless. So I'm speaking about Lambda function or other serverless option for other cloud providers. You can develop your code and based on your code, you will pay on time incremental steps. So if your code runs for some second, you will pay for that time. If your code is running for minutes, you will pay for that period of time. This is useful because better you are programming or the function that you need is running, you will pay only for that time. Okay, so take an example of PaaS. So what does it mean, a machine learning model into a PaaS platform as a service application? You want to deploy it on cloud, you have to first of all choose the real the useful service like AWS SageMaker. AWS SageMaker is like a Python notebook where you can deploy your code, run it directly, without think about installing under services like Python or other libraries that are needed to run it. You can directly deploy from any Git repository. In this case, I used GitHub, that is one of the most common repository services. And you can also use the integration with the continuous integration and continuous development in an easy way. So if you have like a productive environment where you need to deploy some change request or some bug fix, you can directly integrate in the working and real environment and test it directly on your system. A next one example is talking about a database instance. So know that for sure you had the chance to work with database, MySQL, MongoDB, so relational databases or NoSQL databases. How many time you spend to develop a new database instance? In an on-premises solution, you should configure a virtual machine, install the engine of the DB that you chose, configure firewall rules, and make sure that everything is working together. In a platform as a service scenario, for example, using AWS RDS or other database services that later on we will see, with a few clicks, you can create your own instance, giving the computational power that you need for that period of time, and power it on. So you will have a JDBC or ODBC connection string, and you don't have to be worried about anything else. Okay, I can do it. So who is offering all those kind of services? There are mainly three providers, but also other challenging vendors are gaining credibility and functionality over the time. Let's see them. This order is based on a specific study that I will show you later on, but also based on their born date, let me say. So the first one is Amazon Web Services, so is Amazon. The second one is Microsoft Azure, and the third one is the Google Cloud Platform. So AWS was born in 2006. Nowadays is the most popular and mature platform, offering more than 175 services, spread in 25 at least region all over the world. What does it mean? It means that you can choose your own region in order to access to the service nearest to you. So the one that could follow better your needs. Also, for example, based on GDPR solution. So you can have one in Europe or in Asia or whatever you want. So let's go to the next. So, okay. This picture is collecting the most useful services provided by AWS. We could start from the foundation services that are the base of this, let me say, provider. You will find the compute access, so the compute infrastructure where you can deploy your virtual machine. And this is the Elastic Cloud Computing, the infrastructure as a service provided by AWS, followed by the Lambda, that are the serverless function, so the serverless computing that I was speaking just a couple of minutes ago. Then we find the storage and content delivery, where files or objects are stored in secure or private, or both of them, buckets, and are public accessible like the Amazon Content Delivery Network. So this one is a point of access where you can store your picture, for example, website picture, and they are fast accessible from the outside. Regarding database, we could find here the relational database under RDS service, but also the NoSQL database under DynamoDB, and also the analytical one with Amazon Redshift. Under the foundation services, there are also the networking part that is very deep with virtual private cloud and Route 53 to redirect all the traffic that is incoming to your services in general, let me say. Going up to the application services, we could find the software as a service like Kinesis and Data Pipeline, and all the administration and security services that allow you to grant specific users and in the case of production environment for the enterprise application, there are a lot of users and a lot of roles or policies associated to. Finally, in the deployment and management, there are the services deployed for new, let me say, application like the streaming, like SQS, that are the simple queue services, and upstream and clue search in order to have like Elasticsearch ready to be deployed on your specific application or whatever you need. So Azure was born in 2010, is the second most popular provider, great for Microsoft-based users, like .NET development, SQL Server, Exchange Server, and all Windows-based application in general. Like AWS, it is composed by a lot of services, less than AWS, based on area of interest. Also in this case, we could find the infrastructure as a service like the virtual machine, but also data, the database part with SQL and NoSQL databases. On behalf of these databases, you can find the analytical part that is very, let me say, in deep on this, based on this provider. And at its core, Azure replaces also your on-premise infrastructure, or can supplement it because it's able to run parallel with your own. So you can deploy your code, for example, on your on-premises server. And when you need some computational or some power in order to run your code, you can switch it on the cloud compute power. These services are, like I said before, only a part of what Azure can do for your business. And many enterprises across the globe are using all the capabilities of Azure to optimize the business model and the overall infrastructure for their company. The last one, last but not least, is the Google Cloud Platform. Is the younger, was born in 2011, and it is very popular. Because machine learning or artificial intelligence cloud. It is composed by less services than AWS and Azure, but is very popular, as I said before, in machine learning tools. So have a quick look, as I did before, we could start from, as usual, the compute part. So we are able to find the app engine that enable you to build a modern web app on cloud platform, the compute engine that is like the AC2 for AWS or the virtual machine for Azure, where you can deploy your virtual machine on Google's infrastructure. And then you can find the container engine. It's used to automate system deployment and to run containers like Docker in a cloud environment. This is very useful because you can wrap up your container and put it on the cloud, and let's see how it works in the cloud, and also share it with other people, for example. Another part is the storage. It has Bigtable, that is a NoSQL database like the MongoDB, with high performances, and it is based on the Google file system, so it's able to perform queries on data that are stored in, let me say, file system and not table, directly on tables. Data store, cloud data store in this case, is a NoSQL document database, built for automatic scaling, high performances, and easy of application development. The storage in general is a powerful and cost-effective solution to store unstructured objects. So from files to object in general is like, I think, more useful bucket. I think you had the chance to have a look of a bucket in AWS S3. Cloud SQL is a fully managed database that is very easy in this case to manage your cloud SQL engine, and it is directly connected to a storage resource. Regarding the big data part, it offers BigQuery. That is a web service allow you to analyze interactive data sets, and it is easy to use. BigQuery also allow developers and business to perform powerful data analysis on demand, so directly on the data that are on streaming, for example. Pub and Sub is a managed and real-time messaging service that allow streaming and also, let me say, message exchange between application. So, for example, Kafka queue. Then we have Dataproc, that is Apache Spark and Hadoop services that allow you to, let me say, leverage the open source like batch processing queries and streaming. And then we have ML engine that in general provide this kind of services related to machine learning and artificial intelligence. So those specific services are used for models and specific API. So these kind of machine learning services are software as a service, as I said before, while all the compute and storage part is offered as, in this case, infrastructure as a service and platform as a service. So going next, wow, I don't know why it's going twice every time. This one, I don't know if you had the chance to see it before, is a chart provided by Gartner. It's called the Magic Quadrant. In this case, it's for cloud infrastructure and platform services. It's Gartner is a global research and advisory firm that is providing information, advice, and tools for leaders in all industries. So is, let me say, a snapshot of the leaders based on completeness of vision and ability to execute all the services that I showed you a couple of minutes before. So what we are able to see in this slide, that Google, starting from 2018, is going into the leader part, while AWS, that from 2018 was in a leadership zone, is going to have a challenges part. So is always there, but Google is gaining a lot of popularity, I think, based first of all on Kubernetes and let me say containers part. So the main question is which provider I have to choose. So you said that we have AWS, we have Azure, we have Google Cloud Platform. Which one is the best? There is no any best. AWS is the biggest at this point, is the most popular, and for this reason, let me say, nothing attracts a cloud like a cloud. So I think they do really well with the least amount of downtime, and they do a balanced solution and a lot of services, 175, like I said before, on all areas. So starting from compute, storage, databases, analytics, and so on. The last serverless option, AWS Lambda, is the most mature and serverless service that you can find on public cloud provider. The same thing for Azure. Well, it's easy to embrace because most enterprises are already using all the Microsoft suite like Office. And in this case, the idea of have an hybrid solution where you can run something on your premise servers and something on the cloud is very, let me say, useful, and is the gap between the others, organization. Also, as I said before, the opportunity to change, or better, to choose the region where your data are stored is very useful in Azure part, while in AWS you can change, you could change the region in general, and in this case you can change also the specific country. Why choose the Google Cloud Platform? Google did a lot of innovation in machine learning. You can use TensorFlow also in AWS and in Azure, but you know, seems to work better in a native environment. Some customers are using both AWS and the Google Cloud Platform in order to keep the best from each one. So for example, the TensorFlow is working on the Google Cloud and is referring to a bucket in S3 where you are storing your object and maybe because the enterprise is already based on the AWS solution. Regarding prices, I think that has the best prices comparing to others because they are performing a sort of billing based on nanosecond use of the services. So this, let me say, consideration is not applicable to the infrastructure in general, but for sure for all the serverless or, for example, like SageMaker, that is something you know that you are starting, running, and stopping like a service. So, as Tommaso said before, we have a medicine. This medicine is better. I tried to match it with all the services that I talk about. So starting from the point that the machine learning should be reproducible, we are thinking that collecting or creating a sort of Amazon Elastic Container service, so in general a container, is very useful in order to let us share the code between environment, in our case, or customer, for example, with proof of concept, for example. The bucket is a very useful storage where we can store our data, for example, from a Kaggle competition or for some business related info. Based on the testing and monitoring, we are using Amazon CloudWatch in order to see the output of our code. And the code is placed on Amazon SageMaker, where we deployed the model on notebook. We are going to train it based on some condition that Danilo will show you in a minute. And all this part is, let me say, queried by a Lambda function that, in order to be continuous, is always ready to see if something is happening. So, for example, I want to know if this new customer is a valid customer or not. I can ask directly to a Lambda function in order to retrieve the output. In order to be collaborative, we deployed, or better, we are using a Git repository service that is very useful in order to versioning our code based on all environments that we have on our ends. So from me, that's all. I think I will let you, Danilo.
Okay, thank you, Andrea. In this in the last part of this webinar, we are going to see a real use case and a demo that we have developed in collaboration with our customer, that is the Italian department of one of the largest European insurance companies. This project, this use case, consists in developing a new anti-fraud model for a subset of claims, which guarantees shorter times in handling them by the company, and identifies quickly the fraudster, even in presence of few information. The model should be able to operate with all information that are available at the opening of the claim request, when, as I said before, not much information is available, like the expert report or the network of the subject involved. Instant fraud detection is going to substitute two models that were available at the time in our customer. The first was Sherlock, another machine learning model for fraud detection, which is general and is not specialized for any particular claims. So it is supposed to be low performance than instant fraud detection. And more important, it takes days to get an accurate prediction. And it's going to substitute also what is called Motorino anti-fraud, anti-fraud engine, which is a series of business rules with lots of false positive. So this solution was developed entirely on cloud using Amazon Web Services. We started from claims history data that had been already labeled, and they were stored on an S3 bucket. Then, using Amazon Glue and EMR, the two services that let us to run Spark jobs, we did the pre-processing step, where we gather the data that came from different sources, different files. You can imagine different files into a single dataset. And then we did feature engineering, and the result we saved on a DynamoDB table that we will use on during prediction. Then we applied a supervised model. We trained two waterfall machine learning models using SageMaker and Docker. In the first model, we fit a claim amount regressor for a business need, because they want to see an estimate of how would pay for the claim. And at the end, we fit also the fraud classifier. Now the question is, what does it happen during when a new claim needs to be classified? Well, everything is managed by a Lambda function that does the data enrichment, using also the pre-calculated features that we computed before during the pre-processing step. And at the end, it invokes the model to get the prediction. The question now is how to build this solution. In this part now, we go through the code step by step. In this webinar, we are going to build a simplified version, but with the same key concept, with the same core engine of the instant fraud detection, but also using an open data. So now we move to SageMaker notebooks, and we start. So the first notebook that we show is about preprocessing. In this step, in the demo that we are going to visualize, this demo goes to the following steps, in which, in the first case, we did the preprocessing step, where we understand the data, we visualize them, and we make them trainable by the model. Next, we will see the hyperparameters tuning, where we choose the model, choose the hyperparameters that best fits our dataset. Then we test the model on an unbiased on an unseen dataset to get an unbiased evaluation of the model that we have chosen. And at the end, we deploy it. We publish the model in the cloud, so it can be reachable by other services. So as said, the preprocessing step, we are using an open dataset that you can download it from searching insurance claims in Kaggle. So let's start. So I run the cells. So we load the libraries. We set some path inside AWS. So again, we set where the data are stored, and then we load it using pandas, like if it is was it it is it were in local. And at the end, we print the dataset. So we are in front of a dataset composed by 1,000 rows. Each role consists in a claim, and we have 40 features, and each claim is labeled by fraud reported. So we are going to predict this feature. We study also the categorical distribution of the target variable. And here we see that the class are imbalanced. So right now we just know that we are going to build a supervised model, in particular a binary classification. And we also set some weights for managed imbalanced class. Then we split the data into training and test part. And then at the end, we do some feature engineering. In particular, we one-hot encode on split. So first, we fit the encoder on the training data and we transform it. And at the end, we transform the test data. And okay, this time we save simply to NS3 bucket. Okay, I move to the other notebook. In this notebook, we are going to see the machine learning process. In the first case, we concentrate in the hyperparameter tuning. In doing so, we just need to know that SageMaker makes extensive use of Docker containers to allow us to train and deploy algorithms and provides a simple way to package arbitrary code in an image that is totally self-contained. Containers allow developers and data scientists to package software into standardized units that run consistently in any platform that supports Docker. In some ways, we can think a Docker container that is like a virtual machine, but it's much lighter weight. We can package code, runtime, system libraries, all in the same place, isolating it from its surrounding, from the environment. In SageMaker, Docker containers are invoked in a certain way for training and in a different way for during hosting or in the deployment phase. Well, in the Docker containers are read from ACR, the Elastic Container Registry, directly by SageMaker. In the training phase, SageMaker runs the training script inside the Docker container, that in our case is just like a regular Python program, but could be any language that is capable of running inside a Docker environment. So it could be also Java or I don't know, C, C++. Then SageMaker injects the training data from an S3 bucket inside the container under some directory. In this case is OPTML. And at the end, the training program produces an artifact, a model artifact that is written to S3 bucket. Well, during hosting, in this case, SageMaker runs another script called serve that in general is a simple file that starts a server, which get the claim that get the data from an URL, and it responds with the inference, so it get the prediction. Okay, now we can move on. I cannot I don't run this notebook because it takes very lots of time. Okay, we import the libraries. We set some path like where the Docker image is stored on SCR. Then we set also the bucket name, where the data are stored, and the output path, where the model is written. And okay, we can start with tuning the hyperparameters. Well, in order to use SageMaker to fit our algorithm, we use an estimator that defines how to use the container to train. In this case, in the estimator, we set the Docker image. You can think the estimator like a single model with a defined hyperparameters. So the estimator, in the estimator, we can set also the instance count. So you can think how many CPUs are running behind the estimator and how large these instances are, and other other parameters like how much to the max run of this estimator. Well, in this case, we don't want to run just a single estimator, a single model, but we want to compare them in order to choose the best one. In this webinar, we have already choose a model, a single model for simplicity. We are going to use a gradient boosting classifier, but we compare different hyperparameters. But the same idea is if we need to compare different models. So we define an hyperparameters tuner that is a wrapper of our estimator, and we define the objective that we want to optimize, and its type. So in this case, we want to maximize the area under the rock curve. Then we set also how many jobs to run, how many different models to compare, and then we choose the hyperparameters. So each one pick the hyperparameters from this range. So like an example, we set the scale post weight is the weight that we assign to the positive class for managing the class that are not that differs. So we have the scale post weight between 10, 30, 15, and 100, and so on. Or we set like the max depth from 2 to 6 and other hyperparameters. Then we define where the data are stored on the S3, and we pass also a configuration file. The configuration file I show you here. Here we define which model we are going to use, so an XGBoost classifier, and then which method to run. So we want to do the cross validation with 3 false and a test size of 30%, and how to read the input file, and at the end we fit this tuner. So the tuner will run 15 different models. Each of one run the train script inside the Docker. I show you here, but I don't go too much in detail at this time in the code. So with the method run, the cross validation, we just read the dataset and does the cross validation. So we split this dataset into n folds, so in 3 folders, and we fit the model. We fit the model on the training part of this dataset, and then we test, we evaluate the model on the remaining part. This job takes more than 1 hour with just 15 estimator and just 1,000 of data. So it takes quite lots of time. At the end, we can get the best training job, and we can show we can see here the best hyperparameters, like the max depth of 3. And then we compare also the best five models. So here we can see the hyperparameters, and here there is the final objective value. So this is the raw Cauchy that we have chosen before. So it reached a raw Cauchy area of 0.88 on the training data. Okay, now we have chosen the model. It's time for get an unbiased evaluation of this model. In this case, we just define a single estimator with those hyperparameters, and then we pass the training path of the data, the path of the test data, and again the aconfig file. In this case, what it changed is the method run that we want to run the test, and then again we fit it. So this is just prints, and at the end this is the matrix that we reach on the test data. So we reach a raw Cauchy of 0.80, and again also a precision of 62, and recall of 71, that is a pretty high. Well, the last part of this demo, we see the deploy of this model in the cloud. In doing so, as already said, we have to know that SageMaker invokes another file called serv, that in our case is just a wrapper that that starts the server where we do the prediction, and then it also uses two URLs. So it needs a ping where it received the GET request from the infrastructure, and in general there we determine if the container is working and healthy, and then it needs the invocation. There is the endpoint that receives the client inference and does the prediction. Well, having defined these two, we can deploy the model with just a single line of code, where we define the initial instance count and its type. Now, we have the model on the cloud. Now we need it to make a prediction. Suppose we are, sorry, I, okay. Suppose we are in a production environment and we need to classify a new claim. So we have defined a lambda function where we manage this part, the prediction phase. The lambda received a data that comes from other rules, other from the customer. This is the data in a JSON format, and it simply invoke the endpoint. So it invoke the model. I show you here a test. This is live, so it takes some seconds. And here we have the response. So in this case, for this data, for those data, we have a fraud probability of near 40%. So we can predict it as a non-fraud claim. Okay, now this ends the demo session, and I go back to the slide. So here we are for the conclusion. So we have seen in our demo that there are many steps to run in a machine learning project. Each of them requires a synergy, a collaboration in a team. Nowadays, in order to work on an enterprise world, data scientists should be an expert in modeling problems using also mathematical concept. Nevertheless, it is required also to have knowledge for building the infrastructure of the model and integrating it in a production environment. The synergy between data scientists in a team is takes friend by the cloud, which removes the heavy lifting from each step of the process, of machine learning process, to make it easier to develop high quality models. We have seen that SageMaker provides all the components used for machine learning in a single tool set. So models get to production faster with much less effort and at a lower cost. Now, thanks for attending this webinar. We hope you enjoy it. And now it's your time for question and answer.
Okay, thank you for the webinar. We have several questions in the chat. So I think we can start from the top.
Okay. For example, the first one, during my part, how long does each step and the entire project generally take? So the unique answer is it's depend. We work on different projects from a minimum of 3 months for those projects where we follow only one step, for example. Maybe we do the modeling part, but the data is already prepared. But there are projects that could take more than three years when we follow all the steps. In general, independently from the duration, the phase before the ML part or AI in general is most important, because we need to well understand data and prepare data for in order to have high quality results.
After. Okay, there are several questions from Kai. So I think the second and the third one are related to the second part of the presentation.
Oh. Yes, related to the second part, are you meaning to the cloud? Because I think...
Okay, no, the second question is related to the data. So okay. Addressed yes. To Tommaso.
Up to you, Tommaso.
Yes, how are raw data usually sourced? From publicly available source or from client organization? Okay, company data in general. It could be happened that for specific project, we have to use some external file. such campaign or some weather data, I don't know, but it's uncommon.
Okay, so it's not frequent to train a model with external data and then using that model to clients' data? This is my question.
In general, no.
Okay. The third question is related to the project strategy standalone. So if there are custom tailored to a specific client's need, so your solutions, I think, or are you used to use already prepared solutions?
Okay, I try to answer also this. But in general, we try to reuse all the works, so elements, some code, and in general experience from other project. But there is always a phase where we need to readapt the material for the specific customer.
Okay. Okay, and then a question related to a more specific platform for the pipeline. So are you using Apache Airflow?
Okay, I try to respond. Well, we don't use, in our customer don't use the machine learning pipeline because it's they start to do machine learning projects, so they start to be on cloud in very recent for very recent time, so at this time they don't use any machine learning pipeline, so we are training and deploying it also all in SageMaker notebooks.
Yes, okay. Just a bit more regarding this question. I know that for a telco, we are going to scheduling a job, like training a machine learning model on the Google Cloud platform. So we are also starting to use those kind of, let me say, platform. But in general, as Danilo said, we are using SageMaker with code inside.
Okay. So my question is was already answered during the webinar with the slides. Then a question related to how to create a sort of hybrid technology using several cloud providers. So if it is possible to use two or three different cloud providers and then fusing or integrate their services into one single solution.
Yes, it's possible. There are some customers that are doing this kind of application, let me say. In general, it's not very spread because they are focusing, for example, on AWS. They are putting all the data platform on this provider, and so they are using all the services related to it. But in general, I saw, for example, for other, let me say, purposes, so on data part, that we are using Snowflake, that is on Azure Cloud, that is, let me say, reading files from a bucket that is on AWS Simple Storage bucket. So it's directly in S3 bucket.
Okay, thank you. So there are two more questions. Mm-hmm. If you have the chat.
Okay, for the instant fraud detection case, once the project is done, how is the model transferred scaled to the client? Well, the model was, this entire solution was developed entirely in collaboration with the client. So we have, at the beginning of the project, we have imagined how to integrating it and how to use it in a production environment. So there is no anything that, that was transferred by our own machine to the client. And then the SageMaker does everything to manage the scaling, the scaling phase. So we just need to define the initial count instance when we deploy the model. But then we, SageMaker does everything automatically.
Okay. So it's just to select the correct instance type for the deployment phase. Yeah. Okay. Yes. And the last non-technical business related question, just to grasp the overall interest of machine learning, what kind of companies do you usually approach to you? So small, medium, big size company?
I think I could try to answer to this one. We work across industry. So from the biggest telco, the biggest Italian bank and other big companies, as you saw before with the insurance. Basically, we cover all industries except for the public administration and health. So for all the other sector, we are there and for some kind of, in this case, I'm talking about target reply, but in general, reply is pretty everywhere in the big big company.
Okay. So if there are no more questions,
I think we miss the question number six.
Yeah, sorry.
What kind of needs do clients usually refer to you? So I try to answer that with an example. For an important bank, the customer has a solution for detection of money laundering activities and a classification task. In this case, for example, we trained a random forest initially, and then we use a graph-based approach in order to improve the performance of our model, and so we construct a sort of a company network. And we extract from this graph some metrics, such as betweenness, centrality, or page rank, in order to do some feature generation for our forest. I don't know if you, Andrea or Danilo, if you want to add some experience.
Usually we are collecting all the requests and managing them based on the data that we have and let me say the budget that is planned for this project or in general for the project. Starting from that point, we study a model and we try to put it in production. So in general, this is the flow.
Yes, okay. In general, also there are some companies that are working on an agile environment. So everything is in collaboration. You think with objective. So you define which steps to run to do. In order to do the prediction, to build the model. So you work in collaboration with the customer.
Okay, thank you.
Alex, one last point. I'm putting in the chat our LinkedIn account. So please Perfect. Follow us. You will see some events, some community, let me say, I think, interest post. And thank to you.
Okay, I'm stopping the recording.